smoking on some OG. Well, I'm homegrown and I'm leaning on my love.
Up, welcome back.
We are currently in Florida on a little road trip, and we thought we would do a Q&A because it's been a minute since we've gotten anything up on the channel for you guys.
Yeah, we've been in 38 and we're doing a road trip to Jacksonville for another couple days for a birthday party with some friends, and we decided not to vlog this trip, but we thought this would be a great opportunity to do a Q&A on the road trip.
We actually have a couple of vlogs from when we went to 38 last year. It's like comprehensive, and we do the same thing like literally every time.
Same restaurants, so, all that kind of stuff.
Everything.
Citizens is our favorite. George's is great. Pescado, they have a new menu, and the food was really good.
Yeah.
Like Asian cuisine or Asian infused.
It was super good.
Paradise is good. We were going to try to go to Galleon. We couldn't get in this time. But yeah,
it
same stuff.
Lovely.
Ron Juicy.
Ron Juicy is the best. But we're losing sun. Okay.
Yeah, we gotta jump into this. Let's jump into these questions.
Okay.
Sorry, the sun's behind us, but I'm still wearing my sunglasses because it's bouncing off the mirrors, like, into my face. It's been a while since we've done a Q&A on YouTube.
I know. Okay. If you could have three homes anywhere in the world, where would you choose?
Where would the three be?
Yeah.
Good question. I would say a home base. I would say a beach house.
A beach house, yep.
And I don't know if that would be Florida or, like, I feel for some reason
a beach house location
in my mind would be something along the lines of, like, more Caribbean or more island vibe.
Yeah.
Island life. But we haven't explored enough places to really pinpoint where that beach house location would be.
Totally. But a beach tropical destination.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be cool, like, to do a beach house in Europe or something like that, too.
Totally.
I don't know.
And then I would love to have, like, a mountain. Like, in the mountains somewhere. So, like, that would be the three. Like, the home base, beach, and then mountains. Because then you pretty much, like, check off all of, like, your location.
I would love, like, a ranch.
Like a ranch.
A ranch-style house.
Yeah.
And I feel like it'd be cool and close to the mountains to do that.
You know where we should go? I want to go next. It's Montana.
Montana, and I want to hit Idaho.
Yes.
Montana, Wyoming, and Idaho. Like, those states.
Yeah.
But I think real estate there is pretty expensive right now.
Is it?
But there's still, there's like so much land, so you could probably find something. Great question.
Okay. Oh, this is a good question. What do you both do when the other is feeling down?
Go ahead, go first.
Okay. Hunter doesn't get down that often. You know. But I feel like when you get down, I usually try to get you doing like an activity, or I try to like break the
mindset.
The mindset for you, because I feel like that is helpful to have somebody like pull you out of it. So I'll be like, okay, let's get out of the house, let's go somewhere. We need like a shift right now. Like, let's go do an activity, or let's film a video, or I just always try to, like, it can start to become a dark cloud, you know what I mean?
I would say you're good at that.
Yeah.
Like, when I'm down, I feel like you're good at changing my headspace or my environment to help me
just break out of it, yeah. Which you don't really stay there for very long, and that's not very often.
I would say for you, something kind of similar is, like, giving you and presenting you with more positive thoughts and kind of changing how you're thinking about something.
Yes.
Looking more like helping you be more optimistic with outcomes.
Mm-hmm.
And looking at the positive side of things rather than like sulking in like almost like this false fear.
Yes.
Because fear is false.
It's like made up.
It's made up.
Like, I've gotten better.
Yeah, you've gotten a lot better.
Don't you think?
That, and also something that I would say people don't say enough that is important, and we've learned that through our years of marriage, is like space, giving each other space necessary is also important. Like, I'm very much so, I'm more confrontational, and like I like to handle conflict or situations head on and like just work through it.
Yeah.
But not everyone's like that. Like you like to be like have some time to gather your thoughts and
totally.
Over time I've learned to allow you to have that and
yeah.
like have some quiet time and then we can come together and whatever.
Reckons.
But yeah. if it's bad enough and you're like in a bad headspace, it's like no babe, like let's get out
like,
of this.
Let's, like, yeah, like we're not doing this anymore.
The balance, knowing when to step up and when to give them some time.
Totally. Okay, let's see. What do you think are the biggest misconceptions about you?
Biggest misconceptions. Interesting.
I know. I guess we don't know them because
I don't know how people perceive us.
In our, right, exactly. I don't know how people perceive us.
I would say like we're way more low key than people would expect.
Yeah. I think people. Like, what I feedback that we've gotten from people meeting us in person say that we are like they didn't really know what to expect because you know we have a YouTube channel or we have followers on the internet. I guess like there are certain characteristics that come along with that sort of like stereotype,
yeah.
and they have told us that like we're nothing like that.
They fear that you can get like big headed with that,
totally.
And that we're actually pretty
normal.
We're normal and very much like we are on camera.
Yes,
which is such a compliment. Like we love when we hear that because that is our goal. Our goal is to be as normal and real as possible on camera.
Yeah, totally.
And I would say if anything, people are maybe surprised that we're quiet and chill and just like when we're in group setting, we're just kind of like
reserved.
Yeah.
Yeah. Totally. But since this is our channel, we like are more talkative and outgoing
yeah.
in this space because we know it's appropriate. But in a public setting, we're not really.
And it's just us two.
Yeah.
Although the camera is there and like we know people are gonna be watching, it's just us two and we're really comfortable with each other. So.
Totally.
You know, everyone's a little bit different when they're with their spouse than they are with everyone else.
Let's see.
Any other misconceptions you can think of?
I feel like us collectively, that's what it would be. Yes, okay. I think one misconception that I have heard from girls, for me personally, is that because I love like all things like makeup and fashion and home, I think people typically assume that maybe I'm like more like, that I don't have as much like depth or maybe like I'm shallow or materialistic because of those passions of mine. But once you meet me, people are like, wow, there's like way more under the surface or you like are different than I thought. Like
yeah.
I thought that you were just like that girl that like likes all that stuff. And those are just things that I like, but they're really not like my personality. But I feel like if you watch the vlogs, then you know
would
that.
Know that, yeah. Then also and that we're collectively physically smaller than what people expect.
Totally.
We've heard
we're
that
both
before.
Kind of short.
We're both shorter. I'm like 5'9", 5'10".
I'm 5'2".
She's 5'2".
We're very proportionate to each other,
yeah.
but we're like, we're little people.
Little people.
Yeah. What about you? You feel like...
I
would say actually kind of the same, but what I've heard from like our guy friends that have met you in person,
mm-hmm.
they're always like, oh, Hunter's like, way chiller than I expected just because like I think traditionally for men it's like not as acceptable for them to I don't know share their like fashion or
be into home decor
things like that that are traditionally like female interests or female dominated and so people have like a certain idea that you're gonna be like I don't know into like yourself or like it, again like
yeah
I don't know materialistic
overall I don't even know if people think that
I know I think that's just
a
it just comes with that.
It's just a perspective people have on folks who are in social media or on the internet and I would go back to just saying like I definitely have a personality but I'm quieter in group settings more than what people would expect I think
definitely
but over time, as I've gained confidence in social media and on the internet and to be myself behind the camera, it's also helped me gain confidence to not feel like I have to speak a lot in public settings or group settings. When before I felt like I needed to always be like the loud one and stuff like that to show my confidence.
Totally.
But it was like false confidence. Now I feel like I have confidence where it's like I'm down to just like speak when I feel like I need to.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Love that. Something you realized / discovered that changed your life in any way. Maybe like a big like life lesson.
Something you've realized or experienced?
Something you've realized or discovered that has changed your life in a significant way. I would say being so involved on social media has been transformative for both of us, I think, in our like personal journeys. And I think the biggest thing for me, which I touched on this a lot in my Girl Talk Q&A recently, if you missed that, but I battled with like anxiety for a while, and I finally like got really like took the time to like heal that and like figure out the roots and like get rid of it. And I think just the biggest thing that the anxiety was sourcing from was like letting the opinions of other people, whether that was like online or peers or whatever, like those opinions of me or the other voices, like I would let them start to like creep into like my psyche, and then I started doubting myself, and I would actually like buy into them and believe them. And learning that that is like, it's just the killer, and to really only prioritize like my own voice and like my own opinion of myself and the decisions I make and what I want.
And that's not just negative opinions, that's negative, positive, like neutral, just like so many opinions
totally
in general
totally
can get in your head.
Yeah. So just learning to kind of like stay in my lane and actually kind of like keep my like circle and like the things I expose myself to like pretty minimal has been the biggest lesson I've learned. And it actually sometimes like makes you feel like you're being like left out, or you're not like, you know, with the crowd, or you know, have a ton of people around you. But I think it's actually healthier for me personally.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Yeah,
I like that. I've learned that through you myself.
Yeah,
like seeing that. I don't think opinions affect me as much, but they do affect they affect everybody.
Totally.
And I've learned through your trials with that, like how to handle that myself as well.
Yeah.
Secondly, I'll say on top of that, I think really realizing that there's room for multiple passions, and you don't have to just stick to one thing. Like through YouTube, we've shared a lot of our life and exposed a lot of like just everything about us. But that doesn't mean that's all you have to offer. Like there's so many more passions that like you can pursue and create and learn and gain. And it's easy to get comfortable and just stick with what you're good at. But what if there's something you're even better at that you don't know? So like trying a lot of things, and like I kept some of my passions private for a while, like just to prevent any opinions from getting my head and stopping me from pursuing that passion. So like playing the guitar every day, like I probably play like 30 minutes to an hour every day, kind of treat as therapy, or it's like really therapeutic for myself. Like amongst work, I go play the guitar and just like really zone out, and it's good for me. I also enjoy it. It's a passion of mine. I'm by no means the best, I'm by no means the worst, but it's just like a fun thing to do. And I prevented myself from sharing that with everyone for a long time, whether it's like on Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, just to keep that passion of mine. And now that I know I love it and enjoy it, I'm okay sharing a little bit more of that. So continuing to pursue passions, but you know, like not letting any voices tell you yes or no. And that can be not just through the internet, but that can be like family members. Like if there's passions you have and you're in high school or you're fresh out of college and you're worried about what your family might think, your family will support you if you're super happy and you're loving it. So pursue it and find things that make you happy.
Yeah, I would say with that, almost like learning to keep more things private or like to yourself, right? Yeah. Like so, especially in this day and age, not feeling like you have to share everything on social media. It's okay to like keep things to yourself. And it's kind of like hard to do, because when you get excited about something, you want to share it. But once you do it the first time, you're kind of like, it's this kind of a vibe. And it's like nice to just have some privacy.
And that doesn't mean to be fake or not be real and hold things back from sharing. Like,
totally.
When you're sharing, share your authentic self, but that doesn't mean you have to share absolutely everything.
Yes.
On social media.
Exactly.
But also off social media, what I was saying earlier is, like, you don't have to share everything you're pursuing with everyone just when you get excited, because someone can instantly kill that excitement. So.
Yeah. What percentage of your endeavors form your guys' income?
What percentage of your endeavors forms your income?
Right.
Okay. Got it. Yeah, I would say 70% is probably social media.
Yeah.
YouTube, Instagram, TikTok, all that kind of stuff. That encompasses, like, affiliate marketing.
Yeah.
I would say another 20% is probably, like, real estate. And if not more, I would say maybe, like, 30% is real estate. So maybe we'll put social media at 60%.
Yeah.
30% is real estate, and then 10% is, like, investments, like crypto and stocks and stuff like that.
Yeah. Okay. I feel like that's a pretty accurate breakdown.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to do. I don't really do anything with the money, and I mostly run that, but,
And that's definitely changed over time. Like, it probably changes, like, every 2 years or so. Like, look back 2 or 3 years, and our jobs was our primary income.
Yes, definitely.
That was, like, 90% of our income. YouTube was, like, 10%. And then another 2 years go by, and social media is 40. And that's kind of, like, reversed. Now that we've left our full-time jobs, YouTube is the majority of that. And then we've gotten more into, like, real estate investments, stuff like that. Things that we don't always talk about on here. And then same with crypto and stock investments. We don't talk a ton about that on here. But we are into that. And I am big into following, like, the crypto world and investing there. It has its highs and lows.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see here. I know you guys have mentioned you want kids. Is there a time you're waiting on? No. I think that Hunter and I have always just, like, taken the children thing at our own pace. We don't ever, like, have never felt that we need to, like, hit a certain timing. We just always knew that we would know when the time was right, when we really started, like, desiring, wanting to have kids, or getting baby fever, or just feel, I don't know, it's kind of like, I feel like when you meet somebody and you just know that they're the one for you, I also feel like you will know when the time is right for a child, because you really just, like, it's like a love thing, like, you just really want it in your heart.
I hate nothing more when people say you'll never be ready.
I know.
Because that's just, like, people forcing other people to just have kids.
Yeah.
I don't think there's one right way for across the board. It's really, the right way is to have kids when you are ready to have kids.
Yeah. I mean, I think it'll always be nerve-wracking just because it's such a big life change. So you'll always feel a little, like, you know, tingly about it and just kind of nervous.
That, and, like, we talk about this all the time, is that we are prepared to have kids. We were prepared to have kids 5-6 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Those are two different things. Like, you can be prepared to have kids, you can be ready to have kids financially, spiritually, emotionally, all of that. And I think when all of those things align, and then your desires are, okay, I'm ready, like, I'm excited for kids, that excitement will be there. I truly believe that the excitement to have children will be there. And when you have that excitement and you have that together with your partner, that's when you have kids.
Definitely. I think for a long time, Hunter and I, we were just really focused on other things, career. We wanted to travel a lot, and we both just would look at each other, talk about it all the time, and we're like, it's just not, this isn't the right time right now. Like, we don't want it. And then I think your heart starts to soften over time, and as things change, and everything just kind of comes in the right place. And I think we're definitely moving towards that direction. Yeah. And, like,
the past couple years, we've been, like, more excited and, like, see that in our near future.
Definitely.
But, like, near future, once again, can be, like, another 2 years away. We've been saying 2 years every year.
Yeah.
But that year or two year out distance feels realistic now for us, and it never did before. It was just like an answer we would always give.
Totally.
Now it feels like
it feels actual.
We're really excited for children.
Totally.
And we're excited for when that time comes, but there's zero pressure on ourselves. Like, we're not trying by any means.
Totally.
Like, it'll happen when it happens, but we're feeling good about it.
Yeah, I'm excited. Okay, let's see. Do you guys feel like you're over the burnout? I would say yes. So we went through like a heavy burnout phase this year.
End of last year.
We talked about it a lot on the vlogs and everything. And I feel like we're actually like just finally coming out of it.
Yeah.
It took almost like a full 6 to 8 months to really like recover, and we had to really change a lot of our ways that we were
approaching
work and life and work-life balance. And I finally feel like I can take a breath. Motivated again and excited to, like, you know, format a new approach to work that feels fun again and more balanced.
It was really like a priority adjustment we needed to make, like create a balance, really adjust our priorities, and really get ourselves in line. Like, I would say mentally and emotionally more than anything.
Yeah, and I think, like, I would just advise, I feel like a lot of people in our generation are experiencing burnout just from, like, hustle culture, and, yeah, it's like, a big, it was so, like, emphasized for so long, and, like, I was definitely a victim to that. And I would just say, if you feel like you're experiencing burnout, or you're feeling that you're, like, so unmotivated and exhausted, I would allow yourself like a decompression time, you know, and that might be 6 months to a year, and you might need that long to recover, and really just like take things down a few notches, slow things down, and allow yourself more rest time. And I know like in your head it can be really hard to do, because you automatically associate that with like failing, or that you're like not working hard enough, because you're comparing yourself to, like, you know, the probably like hyper rate that you were producing or working. So just be patient with yourself, give yourself time. The motivation will come back, but you have to like have that healing period, I think.
Yeah, and it also allows you to pursue things that make you genuinely happy, and things you're doing for yourself, rather than like in the social media world. It's easy to get to a place where you feel like you're doing a lot of things for all of you guys, or a lot of people that might be following you or whatever, and it becomes less about yourself. And so it's really just like stepping back, seeing what's important to you, and letting yourself go from there.
Totally.
But yeah, I would say we're out of the burnout phase. Like, there's some days that are still like tiring, but that's just work in general. That's not burnout.
Totally.
But we're out of the burnout phase, and we're really excited for what's to come on the channel. Like, we are so excited for kind of the path we have planned, and the vision, and like the passions we're excited to pursue and share with you guys.
We're calling it like wave two, because we feel like we're coming back with like a lot of excitement and ready just for kind of a
something different.
I
think y'all will like it.
You know, don't worry, we're not like going anywhere, just new stuff that I think will be really fun. Okay,
and the glasses can come off now.
Yeah, probably. Okay, what year of marriage was the hardest for you so far? I would say probably like the first year. I think year two was when we made our first like move with each other, and we were like digging through like a lot of like, that's when like kind of deeper, like not like issues start to come up, but there's like deep conversations where it's like shit gets real, and then you're kind of like, okay, now we're like working through this stuff, we're building our life together, we moved, like it was kind of like in the weeds.
That was year one. We got married and moved like 3 months later.
Yeah, well, wouldn't you say moved?
I was thinking that was year two, but that was year one.
Yeah, that was probably the hardest, but once we got through that,
we went from being together every day to having this like long commute.
Yeah.
We're away from each other all day, which is normal for everybody.
Yeah.
And then we get home really late at like 7 o'clock after a long commute back.
Yeah.
And then you were like filming videos, and we were like both kind of editing videos, and our life was just different. It was different than it is now.
Yeah.
And I would say it wasn't necessarily because of our relationship. It was because of other factors that were affecting our relationship. But even then, it wasn't bad. We just were... I felt like we were... different people because we were so tired or something. We didn't...
Yeah, we're just
connect as much.
We were like in the growing phase of like building. Like we were just starting, trying to like find our path as a married couple. And kind of like, what are we doing? Where are we going? We just moved. We were in a new place. Like
it was like our second or third job. We were trying to find like what made us happy in our careers and stuff like that. And everyone goes through it. It's rare to just like leave college and you start your dream job right off the bat. Like we went through 3 or 4 jobs each.
Yeah.
And those different jobs and stuff, like it's hard. You're like busting ass to learn a new career and learn a new role
and
do
like,
well in that role.
Totally.
And we really put that career progression over our relationship for a while, I would say.
Yeah.
I did for sure.
Yeah.
I kind of made my job my number one priority.
Yeah.
Over making sure, like, your heart is good or, like, we're in a good place.
Yeah.
In our relationship. But that was, I would say, year one.
Yeah.
We haven't really had... And even then, it wasn't
bad. We were doing it. Doing the thing.
We're just part of it.
Hustle, get going, you know. What are you and Hunter's Enneagrams? I am a 4.
I am an 8. Wings of...
You're an 8, yes. We don't really, like, know that much about our Enneagram, but we do know our types.
I just know everyone always asked me, and they would say I thought I was a 7. And I still didn't know what that meant. And then I finally took it, and the result was an 8 wing 7. So, that's all I know. I don't know what it means.
The challenger. But. And I'm the individualist. Okay. Would you guys ever get a second dog, or do you prefer having just one dog at a time? I think that... In my dreams, I would love to be the crazy dog lady with 5 dogs or more than that. But I think we probably, I don't know, I really like having one because we still do travel quite a bit. And I just feel like having multiple dogs is just not smart or sound decision to do right now with our lifestyle. Maybe in the future when we have kids and we're like grounded a little bit more and not like traveling around as much, I would... definitely given more dogs.
We feel bad even having one with how much we've been traveling.
I know.
We miss Booker so much.
We like definitely, I feel like when our last dog, Noah, for those of you guys who know our last dog, we would travel all the time and we were in this really like fun phase of life where we did lots of trips and stuff and we would miss him and everything. But Booker, like, I don't know what it is, but we literally, like,
pulls
miss him.
Pulls
at our heartstrings. We miss him so much to the point where we, like, start planning when we do our trips, we go shorter amount of time because we're like, we don't want to be away from him for that long.
Or he almost, like, oh my God, ruins the feeling of going on a trip. You're like,
because you feel so bad. I know. But we have an incredible person that watches him.
That helps so much, having our dog watcher who lives on a farm, and Booker loves it. Like, Booker loves this guy.
When he comes over, Booker like pees. He gets so excited and he like
jumping around,
licks him, and he loves it.
And he has 4 or 5 other dogs. He's a dog trainer. He has other dogs coming to his property while Booker's there, and they just play on the farm all day long. Booker loves it. So we feel good about that. It's not like he's like shoved in some kennel at a boarding center or something like that.
No.
I don't think I could ever do that.
No, I don't think I could either.
But like we did it with Booker, but we did it with Noah, and it always made us feel really bad.
I know.
He would get a lot of playtime and stuff, and we'd watch him on cameras. But yeah,
he liked it.
Back to the question though, would we get more dogs? I see us getting more dogs in our future if we ever had like a farm style property where we maybe had like
lots of land,
some other animals like some sheep. Some horses or cows or I don't know, whatever, like more of a farm style property. I would want a few dogs, and I would say that's after kids, after we're kind of like over our travels and maybe like settle on a bigger property or something like that. That's when I would want more dogs.
Definitely.
not in like the suburbs, you know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
Suburbs.
Yeah. Are you guys going to open an online shop with your home decor finds? Maybe one day. We're working on it up in the brain right now, guys.
I would say that's part of wave two and the direction we are transitioning to.
We would love to do that. Yeah. We're figuring out how that would work, what's the best way to do it.
That and what route we want to go. Like, we both feel strongly about designing our own pieces. We also feel strongly about, like, our antique finds and being really passionate, pursuing that passion.
Yeah.
And so it's like, which route do you go? Is it a combination of the two? Is it resale of pieces that we curate? Stuff like that. So it's really kind of just figuring that out. And if it's like something we want to do as like more of a brick and mortar store and online shop, we talk about it all the time. We've been talking about that for like 2 years, a year and a half.
So yeah, I feel like that would be literally the dream. If you guys pay attention to our like the decor that we share on the channel, you know, it's a huge passion of ours, and we kind of see it as our number one interest, and trying to figure out ways that we can turn that into something just more fun and you know, as a part of an experience. And I don't know how it looks yet.
It's not even so much about like the income it would bring in.
No,
just more
just
about
for
like
enjoyment.
If it was making $0, what route would we want to go?
Yeah,
where we're like enjoying it the most and pursuing it as much of a passion as possible.
Definitely, but we love it so much. I literally, you guys have dreams about furniture. I had a dream the other night that I was going around to antique and thrift stores and like finding like people that had like dropped 50 pieces of furniture, and I was freaking out and like so excited about it. I'm like, this is crazy. And we dream about like landscaping yards and like stuff like that. It's like, it's literally what we like have dreams about.
I had a dream two nights ago that we had a two-story house, and the second floor was a gallery of art and furniture pieces.
That's cool.
Which is weird.
I love that.
Because I've been actually thinking about more of a gallery-focused home store. Where it's like, I don't know. When I think of a home store, I think of like more of a gallery style. Where it's like art pieces. Like art. I view vintage and antique finds as art. I don't know.
No, I think it's kind of, all the same.
Yeah.
How has your spirituality or faith in God changed since the pandemic and moving to Tennessee?
Good question.
Great question. I would say for me personally, I feel like Hunter and I, like, obviously, like, everyone's spirituality is, like, super individual.
It's your own walk.
Definitely. I think mine has just strengthened, like, so much and grown way deeper since our move to Tennessee. I think that the pandemic was just, like, really hard, and when we were back living in Texas, I was just kind of, I think, since COVID was just a tough period. I did a lot to, like, if I'm just being honest, distract myself by like working or, you know, finding things to fill my time, and I wasn't really like spending a lot of time talking to God or paying attention to like my intuition, like that's like the Holy Spirit, like God breathed inside of me. So I think slowing down after our move to Tennessee and figuring out some balance, I've had way more time to develop that relationship and strengthen like how to hear his voice and figure out like just, you basically have to like make time for it and get more in touch with it. And so I think it's gotten stronger, and I'm still, I feel like, just learning how to get even closer.
I would say I have some kind of similar thoughts to that. But before I say that, I want to say in Texas, we had a home church we really liked, but it quickly became something that was just like a habit and something that was like part of our routine, and we weren't getting as much out of it as we had hoped. And when we moved to Nashville, we tried a couple churches. We still haven't found like a home church or anything like that, but we've started to almost like seeing the Spirit guide us through ways that didn't involve just like hearing a sermon. Like, we've been able to experience God in a number of ways and see it in more like
on an individual
simple
level.
Things throughout your day that I never really thought of before as spirituality or as my Christian walk, right? But it was nice to step back and say, what does this actually mean to me, and not what does it mean to other people? Accepting
yeah, that. Well, I think too...
Because I grew up in church, so I had like this like routine of what it meant to be...
Going and...
Yeah, what it meant to be a Christian, or like, here's the rules, here's the good, here's the bad, X, Y, Z. And now it's... I see it in such a more like simpler form, and am able to feel the spirit more than I ever have before.
Definitely, and I think that... just having kind of like a season where we're a little bit more, I don't know, like on our own or individual, which won't be forever, and like we understand that, it has just been necessary for us to really develop and strengthen our own relationships with God, like through ourselves, because I think what can happen is, or at least what for me was going into church and being around people, it can kind of just be a distraction, and I don't know if I ever really built that foundation on my own by myself. It's like you have to learn how to like walk before you can like go run in like a group, you know what I mean? So I really needed like that time to just really like build and find that, find my way, and it has to come from within. Like you really have to desire, want that, and have to create time for it on your own, or you can't like, expect it to just happen by like hanging out with the right people. You know what I mean?
Agreed. Going to church doesn't mean you believe in God. Going to church is an opportunity to open your mind and expand. It's teaching. It's what it is. When you go to church, it's additional teachings that maybe you want to be teaching yourself, but you're teaching yourself a ton of other things, and like God is teaching a lot of other things through your own spiritual walk and the spirit inside of you. So
yeah, and I think one other thing from moving to Tennessee, I feel like been exposed to a lot of other people in the city that have different forms of spirituality, and if anything, it just kind of like expanded my heart to like have respect for everybody in their own like path and how they find God or get in touch with God, and that can look different for everybody. And I think as long as like you remember that like love is at the center of that, then you can really like learn from God in so many different ways, and everybody has their own way of doing that. And that's really cool. So yeah,
for sure. All right, let's do one more question. It's getting pretty dark, and this light is kind of blinding me.
Okay. What is something you are both working on improving? Can be physical or mental, whatever. Love you guys.
Working on improving.
Yes. Okay. Gosh, I have so many. Like, always working on some stuff. Okay. One thing that I am working on right now is specifically in my like motivation to creative every day, because I have found that that is something that is really important to me, because over the past year through my ups and downs, I realized like a pattern. If I'm not creating things or like expressing my creativity, that is when I like have the worst days, or I'm actually like the most sad, and I was able to kind of like pick up on that. So I'm trying to figure out and push myself and to find a way to like have that flow every day and make sure I'm expressing myself creatively through some outlet at least once every day. So that could be, I don't know, like drawing for a while, it could be styling outfits, it could be work, like doing something around the house with home decor, singing, dancing, whatever, just something.
Trampoline,
yeah.
Me, it's diving in. I talked about this earlier, but just like diving into passions that I've just like let set aside. Like there's so, I have so many desires inside of me of things I want to pursue, and it's a matter of just like stepping up and doing them. I think we let our day-to-day get the best of us sometimes.
Totally.
And like whether it's like a routine and just like sticking to that, or the workload sometimes piles up where you just push your desires or push your passions to the side. and you're like, oh, I'll get to that tomorrow, and it kind of just, like, keeps passing by. But, you know, getting back to, like, doing things with my hands and, like, doing more woodworking again.
Yes.
More sketching, more art, more music, stuff like that. Just, like, being, whether that's creative or just, like, hands-on projects. I really enjoy that. And since moving to Nashville, I stepped away from doing more hands-on, like, like home renovation and stuff like that.
Totally.
I used to do a ton in Texas, and I loved all of that, and loved doing more woodworking projects and stuff, or like building the fire pit. And whether it's our busy schedules or just like having more friends now to consume our time, I've let some of those things slide, so it's getting back on track with those things.
Totally.
That's
good.
Outside of that, I would say for us just to like continue to expand what we're working on, even
yes.
within the business.
Yes.
So just like not getting comfortable and pushing ourselves to do more, because I know
like
we truly do believe in ourselves that we can do more than what we're doing, and
yeah.
it's just acting on those things.
Definitely. It's exciting.
Yeah, I think we always challenge ourselves too to be like better people, better friends, mm-hmm. be the best person you can, and that should show in your friendships, in your relationships, with family members, all that kind of stuff.
Totally.
So, and that's where we're at. We're very much at a place where we're trying to be the best we can be and do it in a way that, like, brings us joy.
It's sustainable
yeah.
and realistic and not, it just has to come from the heart, right? So
joy is important.
Yes, it is.
Super important. Go find your joy.
Find your joy.
Let it.
Things that are warm.
Yeah.
Feel
joyful.
Good. Okay. Well, we're going to wrap with the Q&A because it's dark, obviously.
That was fun.
We liked it. We'll do more.
Yeah.
And some of you asked what we were going to Jacksonville for. We are going to, oh, we already said at the beginning of the video, we're going to celebrate our friend's birthday, Anna Grace.
Anna Grace. She moved to Jacksonville.
Yeah.
And we haven't seen her in a while, and it's her birthday tomorrow. So we're driving down. Some other friends are flying down, and we're celebrating her birthday.
Yeah. Can't wait.
But,
so we love you guys. We will be back to vlogging when we get back to Nashville. We're just like kind of taking a little breather, enjoying our trip.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, we'll get back on.
We've said this before, and I'll say it again, but we really do appreciate you guys. We're thankful for y'all.
So
and even in 30A at the beach, like, a few of y'all came up and
I
said
know.
Hello, and it just means a lot to us, like, seeing meeting y'all in person and
yes.
seeing, like, more than just the people behind the screen leaving comments.
You guys are, like,
y'all
yeah.
are awesome. We love
like
you guys.
Like, our friends.
Yeah.
And it was so cool. Like, we always are reminded of that when we get to meet people in person. So if you ever see us out about, we love getting to meet you guys and getting to talk to you, because it just makes the whole experience feel
it's
more real.
It's not weird at all. Come say hello.
Not at all.
We appreciate it. We love it.
Yeah.
And just a reminder to ourselves at how grateful we are,
yeah.
but also like how it almost makes us proud of like the community we've built.
Yeah.
Because we see y'all and y'all are so normal, and we just yeah we love it. So
sweet. You guys are so sweet, cute. Anyways, okay, we'll see you guys soon back in Nashville. We love you.
Adios.
Bye.